Yeah, thank you. All right, so you heard about stem cells, and this is a technology that we just recently published, and this is all about how plasticity can be turned on in adult tissue in the live body without going through any stem cells. And why are we interested in such a technology? I'll try to explain that. So the foundation of regenerative medicine, for the most part, relies on, thank you, cell plasticity, the principles of cell plasticity. So this we know a long time back. Embryonic stem cells are highly plastic and give rise to a bunch of cells, and you can use those and make a whole bunch of other cells. And then we heard this previous talk about iP cells. And for those of you who do iP cells, the crux of the matter is it's not a simple approach. Numerous steps in the laboratory need to take place. And from a translation standpoint, it's not very simple. That's the lesser of the bigger problem. The bigger problem, as we see it, is that when you try to generate iP cells, you have all these steps in the laboratory, finally you do get them, and then you're trying to take them into, say, particular cells of interest, say a neuron or a myocyte or what have you. As you saw in one of the slides of the previous speaker, what you have is a bunch of cells that actually achieved the terminal fate. Then you have a bunch of cells that are somewhere in between, and then some residual iP cells. The point being, you have some cells, as we see it, that is what we wanted, but then there's a whole bunch of other cells that have residual stemness in them. So what's the problem with that? The problem with that is, and there are papers for each of these criteria, it's a brief talk, so I'm trying to sort of summarize. So if you change surface texture, cell density, media composition, if you add other cells, anything that is plastic or has residual stemness to it will respond to all of the above and more that I don't list here. So think of all these cells being reprogrammed in a petri dish into stemness, and then they're being taken from the petri dish and put in vivo, where they now have to negotiate with numerous other cell types, a very dynamic changing environment where, of course, all of the above, you know, the fluid, the surface texture, everything is changing. And it would be too naive to believe that we, the scientist or the clinician working with this, has complete control on the fate of all those cells that have residual stemness. And as is evident in the literature, some of those in clinical studies have been shown to go hayward, and we have had evidence of cancer. So the point is, can we achieve the same plasticity and N-terminal fate and completely bypass stemness? So that's the challenge here. Now, is this possible? If one goes back to the in vitro literature, there are a bunch of studies now that claim that they have achieved direct conversion. Direct conversion is where stemness has been bypassed. And in vitro, there is evidence that cells, say for example from fibroblasts, have been converted to a bunch of different types of cells. Most of these techniques are using viral vectors, which we know is a problem as it relates to translation because of, you know, mutagenicity, genomic integration, so on and so forth. So that's a problem. And this is not something that is very well achieved in vivo. This is all in vitro. So you still have to deal with these residual immunogenicity, so on and so forth. So our goal is to find a technology that will induce stemness within the live body, zero procedure in the laboratory, without using viral vectors. Okay? With that background, let us see what we have now to play with. So regenerative medicine, you have been hearing the keynote lecture, then the previous fascinating lecture, essentially will be measured not so much by some extraordinary scientific developments, but by the impact it makes, the bottom line impact it makes to outcomes. So it's wonderful to have thorough science, but then eventually there has to be a bottom line, which is change in outcomes. So to that end, we are looking for a technology to reprogram within the live body Because if we are able to do that, then that happened under immune surveillance. So as it was happening, immune system had a chance to play in and either reject it, and therefore we failed, or we find a way where we satisfy the requirements of the immune system and still achieve the fate that we wanted. It will be happening in negotiation with the complex, dynamic in vivo microenvironment, very unlike what you have in the Petri dish, where things are very much in our control, very clean, therefore makes for great publications. However, if one carefully thinks about it, it is almost impossible to maintain those conditions in vivo. And therefore, we think this is more towards a sustainable functional impact. So, of course, you know, a part of the study is already published. Very briefly, almost all of you are familiar with the concept of bulk electroporation. As opposed to bulk electroporation, where you pass electric field, and what happens in a bulk electroporation process, if you think of a cell, and you, for lack of a better expression, electrocute it, some cells will be so injured that they would die. So those are gone, okay? Some cells will have holes all over the membrane, and while they had those holes, whatever we put outside would have gone in, and some of the cells would have successfully sealed their holes, and now we call that successful gene delivery. Now what we studied is the present premise of our technology is when we do that, indiscriminate injury to the cell membrane, you blunt the inherent plasticity of that cell. So our premise is that every cell has its own inherent plasticity. It doesn't have to be a stem cell in order to have some level of plasticity in it. The question is, can you maximize those plasticities with certain techniques? But if you injure the cytoskeleton, only the cell, by our measures, are alive. They have blunted. So we have found out our technology, which we now call nanoelectroporation. So the first paper came out a few years ago from Ohio State in Nature Nanotechnology. And the second paper ever since, like last 6 years, we have been developing an in vivo nanochip that can do the similar stuff in organ in vivo. So that's what the current work is. But this was published a long time back, where we open up a very small window within the cell, not to be more than 2%. Can you try to play this video by clicking here, please? Thank you. So in this case, we are able to achieve a deterministic transfer of material. Sir, at the audio visual control, can you please press a button here and play this video? Thank you. So what you will see is that the transfer is highly controlled. We know we open up a pore and we can close it when we want, and we can get exactly what to deliver in it, and we don't have to injure the entire membrane. So that is the key difference between what you know as bulk electroporation and our technology. I'll skip most of the big details, but if you have questions, you know, the hardware is now manufactured in an industrial scale by a manufacturing, you know, body. So it's now, it used to be nanofabrication in the lab, but now that is not the case anymore. So what you have here is, say, the skin. In this case, we have a positive electrode and a negative electrode, a positive electrode under the cell, under the skin, I mean. And then you have this, what we call our nano chip here, which is loaded with a cargo of interest. In this case, for the sake of example, we are using ABM, which is a published cocktail for reprogramming in vitro to neuronal cells, fibroblast neuronal cells. So what you do is 10 milliseconds, 10 times, 100 millisecond pulse, and that's all it takes in our technology, nothing else in the laboratory. You have a cargo, and I'll talk about different cargos for different fate, and then this cargo is delivered in 10 pulses of 10 milliseconds, a total of 100 milliseconds. You walk away from that animal, no other procedure needed. Everything else I show you, no other intervention needed. That is the only intervention needed in our technique. So just some, you know, you send some fluorescently tagged and you sort of trace them, they've gone there. What you see is in the beginning it's in the epidermis, and then you will start seeing that some of these delivered transcription factors or genes or whatever you have delivered, you know, gradually move through and enter the dermis and so on and so forth. So here you see is the epidermis, you know, the IBM that we delivered in the epidermis, and then gradually they start moving into the dermis, so on and so forth. All right, and I will talk about EVs later on. In some of this transport, we also have shown that some of this movement involves EVs. I will not have the time to get into the details. So I'll be mostly addressing the broad facts here. So what you see here is a dermal fibroblast in vitro. I will qualify what is, and that's not the intent, because you know, this is easy to show mechanism in vitro. So I'll show you and convince you that it is switching without going through any IP mechanism into neuronal cells, which you just heard is not easy to do. And then I'll go in vivo and show you what it does in vivo. So these are, you know, dermal fibroblasts. And in this case, I'm talking about a vascular genic reprogramming. So these cocktails were developed in our laboratory. If you go to the literature, you will find a bunch of cocktails that people have reported in major journals showing that they have been able to reprogram fibroblasts into endothelial cells. And if you read the papers, they're written as such, almost like blood vessels have been made. When we tried using those factors, we get a whole bunch of endothelial cells, but we don't get a whole bunch of blood vessels. And the two are not the same, as you know. So we went back to fetal vasculogenesis and found our code. And those codes are EFF in this case. If you now use the EFF code, and this is now in vitro, and do that to dermal fibroblast, this is now the EFF vector entering. After a while, you start seeing the cells, spindle-shaped fibroblasts, assuming a cobblestone morphology, like in endothelial cells. If you start looking at fibroblast markers over a period of 7 days, this is your mock, and that's your EFF. They start shedding their FSP1, and they start acquiring PKM1. If you now take the same fibroblast and do a Matrigel analysis, no angiogenic cords are formed. If you take a positive control of a human microvascular endothelial cell, you can see the cord formation. You take the same cell and you run them through a TNT EFF, and you can start making similar looking cords from these stem cells that otherwise could not make the cord. So to sort of summarize this process, you have a free fabricated TNT nanochip, as we call it. These are produced as scalable wafers. We have now done mouse to pig. We're in the process of FDA, so we cannot do humans right now. But through the Ohio Tech commercialization process, we have gotten a manufacturing grant. So this is now manufacturing these nanochips in a proper manner. Prior to that, it was all nanofabricated in the laboratory. Other than that, there's no laboratory process needed. This, you can have the cargo in your pocket, lyophilized cargo in your pocket, and it's field friendly. And 100 milliseconds is all you need, and we prove in the paper that there is no host genome integration. So just a quick example here in vivo. So this is your TNT mock. So this is a skin and vessels in the skin. That's your TNT EFF only in day 7. If you now go to a more functional side of this, what you will see is in the very superficial part of the skin, in the top 3 millimeters of the skin, if you do a Doppler study, you would see trickling of blood, no pulsatile blood flow. In our case, what we call outside-in vessels originating from the skin are now moving to the muscle and the bone, and I'll show the in vivo study for that. And then in that case, you will see pulsatile blood flow in that very superficial part of the skin. This type of blood flow physiologically does not exist. So if we come quickly to the model, you have a femoral transection. So you ligate the femoral, then you transect it. Some people just ligate and there's some leaking. In our case, a piece of the vessel is just taken off. And then what we do is we do not do our TNT immediately before or after the trauma. So if this is trauma, we don't. We have waited until day 3. So everything we publish in that Nature Nano paper, is day 3, so up to 72 hours. Why? Because after 72 hours, we cannot reverse. That's our window. Up to 72 hours of trauma, if you waited and went ahead and did this, then the following can be seen. So what is the following? So here you see black 6 mice. There you see bulb C mice, two different models. And you got ischemia done. So you see how the blood flow in this leg has disappeared, became blue. And using our system, in a matter of day 10, day 14, you can remarkably recover blood flow. Similar can be obtained. In the case of bulb C, what happens is, if you take away the femoral, they undergo what you call auto-amputation. a part of the leg will necrotize and fall off automatically. And in those cases, if you did TNT EFF, the entire pink leg can be seen as shown here. Again, it takes about day say 7, you see a little bit, but day 14. So day 10 and 14, you start seeing functional recovery. So that's a close look at the biopsy and what is the fate of the foot. If you take away the femoral, this is when you did a TNT EFF. Now, of course, just by providing blood supply to the skin, a leg would not function. So we had to go take a look at the muscle, underlying muscle. So we did muscle studies and showed, I don't have the time to show here, but vascularization of the muscle, recovery of the energy status of the muscle. And then a very interesting story came up, which is we are reprogramming a part of the skin in the entire hind limb. How come the entire hind limb got reperfused? And that is what we show. Entire hind limb reperfused. And then the answer to that is we were able to demonstrate that, let me see, where is my, oh, here. We were able to demonstrate that when we did the TNT EFF, the TNT EFF plus a dozen plus physiological factors got packaged by nature, not by us. They originated from the skin, and these EVs contained our EFF that we sent, plus a bunch of other physiological factors, the criteria of which we don't know, and they were dispatched into the blood. And those EFF-rich EVs we show in the paper homed in the ischemic tissue and perpetuated the vasculogenesis process. So if you go forward, in this case, so of course this experiment we were asked to do, which is don't do any TNT. Take away the femoral and take EVs, those EVs, from some other animal and inject that into some other animal, and can you achieve vasculogenesis? And the answer is yes, you can. So you can inject those EVs 3 days after the trauma, which is the transection, and you can fully recover. So you can fully recover blood flow to the limb. And in this process, we say TNT, but this TNT was done to some other animal. To this animal, no TNT was done, only injection of EV. And of course, you can do omic characterization of the EV cargo, and you can see what all are there that actually enables this vasculogenesis. So in an editorial came out in Science Translational Medicine, talking about how the skin can be used as a bioreactor. And we talk about developing all these fancy gadgetry bioreactors outside our body. Guess what? It will never match the complexity and the dynamicity of the body. So the skin, the excess adipose, there's other projects in our lab currently going on that actually exploits, the excessive tissue that we have. And anybody asks, this is not dedicated to the skin. We have gone into the body, we have developed catheters that have these chips in there and gone in, and we can also successfully reprogram organs within the body. We started with the skin because that's a low-risk organ. You can't mess things up. So once we know what we are doing and we know thoroughly, this can certainly be extended to go inside the body and start working on different organs. So quickly, to finish, so again, here we propose, in this case, we are showing the skin as a bioreactor, and the process is happening under immune surveillance. There was also an editorial in JAMA that also touts the significance of this type of an approach. Finally, in the last couple of slides, I show you, in this case, we actually did a TNT ABM on the skin of the fetus when it was within the uterus. So we did TNT in utero. And when these animals were born, we published this, and the neurons were all aligned along the notochord. Very interesting. And we are currently working on the trafficking on these neurons. And this type of alignment and trafficking does not happen in the adult animal, but in utero, when you do, we see a very effective trafficking, and we need to understand how do we know? We don't. If you now go in vitro, you deliver in day 2 or 3, you can see the ABM in the cell. And then 4 and 5, you can see TUG1, MAP2, early markers of neuronal development. And day 20, you see electrophysiology of the skin. And so the neuronal cell bodies are not supposed to be in the skin, but now you see hundreds and thousands of neuronal cell body in the skin that are showing you electrophysiology. Finally, I know I'm running out of time now, so if you want to really look, you can start staining for neurofilaments, synapsin, cholinesterol transferase, and the entire development process of the neuron can be traced. And these are some of the electrophysiology markers that we did. Again, this is all published. And if you now take that piece of the skin and put it through an omic analysis and ask your pathway analyzer to call it an organ, it will say that these are forming brain cells. There's nothing about skin in the tissue anymore. After you have done the TNT-ABM and waited for 3 weeks, these are the type of hubs that you will see, production of cortical neurons, neurogenesis of stem cells, in localization of neurons, excitation of retinal ganglion cells, olfactory bulb. So this is quite interesting that you have completely changed over the genetic makeover. We have also used this to shrink tumors. I'll not get into the details, should you be interested. We did not publish this yet. This is not published work. We have just found the cocktail that will turn skin into beta cells. So you will see all these beta cells that are now homing in the hair follicle niche, hundreds of them, and they will provide insulin to all these diabetic animals. We have tried ceftazidime, DBDB, NOD, and you can bring back, I'm sort of rushing ahead a little bit. So here you see we had a version, and then we have a version 2.0. So version 2.0, the cocktail, genetic cocktail that we're using has changed. It relieves the pancreatic islet, which is, explodes when you have uncontrolled diabetes, and you start generating these islets in the skin, which then rescues the islet in the pancreas. And if you look at the disease, so the blood glucose going up over time, in our case, we are seeing up to 12 weeks we can control. And then somebody is telling me that the mouse skin may be turning over in 12 weeks, so we'll have to see how we can. So after 12 weeks, it again goes up like this. Well, for 12 weeks, we are controlling it pretty well. These are some of the initial data, but you can show insulin production from those beta cells. All of that is traceable. With that, finally, the university actually generated some videos. So the video got some 177,000 hits in the last half a year or so. It's in YouTube. If you write Ohio State Regenerative Medicine, I encourage you to take a look at that video because it was meant for mass dissemination. And of course, anybody here, young folks, want to do this technology, come to our lab. We have fellowship. Thank you very much for your attention.